gratitude, grateful, being thankful. All of those words, all of those feelings are things that we say and do and hope to live into every single day. But sometimes they're tough. We're looking at how to live a grateful life and the transformative power of doing so as we worship together. So we welcome you to Muncie Memorial United Methodist Church and are glad that you are with us for worship today. We want to know that you've worshiped with us and invite you to go to muncie.org/connect and complete a connection card there. Especially, we'd like to know if there are ways we can pray with you, and we invite you to leave that information with the connection card. Come, let us worship together.
Please share with me now in the call to worship. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you.
Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous, and give thanks to God's holy name.
I will extol you, my God and my King, and bless your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and God's greatness is unsearchable.
Our opening hymn is Rejoice, the Lord is King.
Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Mortals give thanks and sing and triumph evermore. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say. Jesus the Savior reigns, the God of truth and love. When he had purged our stains, he took his seat above. Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say.
With you and with ourselves, O God, we acknowledge that too often we are people who focus on what ultimately doesn't really matter, or we focus on what hurts our relationship with you and with others. Please understand that we are stressed these days. Frustration and uncertainty abound, and it is difficult to see the good that is all around us. Yet there you are, even in the midst of the turmoil, leaning into us, calling us into your presence, guiding us to a place of peace. Give us the strength to respond to you so that you might use us to strengthen others. Wrap your loving arms around those who are desperately lonely, those who are fighting disease or depression, and those who are experiencing losses of all kinds. Help us to see where we might be bearers of light and hope in your name. Help us to be people who recognize that you fill our lives with good things, even when we do not see them. Help us to be people who notice and appreciate and express gratitude to you for being our God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being our good and gracious God.
Good Sunday morning to you all. I'm here with my best bud, Peter. And you are, show your shirt real quick. It says happy and thankful. It was a complete accident. We did not intend for you to wear this shirt, but it goes perfectly with what I have prepared to tell you guys today. We are talking about gratitude, and gratitude is a really big word that just means thankful, and we are all thankful for things. But before we talk about that, I have some pictures to show you, and you guys got to think about what this symbol makes us think about. So, what holiday do you think of when you see this?
Clover Day.
Clover Day, St. Patrick's Day. Yeah, St. Patrick's Day. All right.
Mickey Mouse Day.
Mickey Mouse, well, this is not a holiday, but Mickey Mouse, yeah. And what? Let's see, I use Droid, so I don't know if you'll know what this is. It is an apple. Well, it's not a holiday, sweetie. But we are talking, this can represent, you know, iPhones or anything.
It's like an apple on, like, computers.
That's exactly it. That's exactly what I was going for. And an apple on a computer, it's representing Mac. We also have noises that make us think of something. For example, if I sing da-da-da-da-da, you might be singing, I'm loving it, and think about McDonald's, and all of a sudden you want a Happy Meal, don't you? My kids love Happy Meals. You know, we have these symbols that make us think of other things. For example, this is not, and we're not talking about a real apple, and then we're talking about computers or iPhones or iPads. So we have these symbols of something that make us think of something else. In our Christian faith, we do this all the time. You know, Jesus said to have communion every time we are together, to take bread and wine and use it to remember of Christ's love. You know, this season we're talking about thankfulness, like we said on your shirt. We're talking about gratitude. And I'm wondering, what can we think of,
Mama,
or what can we do to form a new habit that every time we do it or see it, or hear it, we can remind ourselves to say thank you. Thank you, God. You know, one thing that I do every day, and I hope you do every day, is brush my teeth. What can I be thankful for when I'm brushing my teeth? I'm wondering if I can make a personal goal every single day that when I brush my teeth in the morning, I'm thanking God for all of his creation. And when I brush my teeth in the afternoon or in the evening, I can thank God for all the people that he placed in my life that day. What can you do? What is a sound or a symbol or something? It could be the color yellow. It could be a pumpkin. It could be a Halloween and something. But something that makes you think about God, and not just think about God, but to say thank you, God. What can you do? Let's pray real quick. Dear God, you are amazing, and thank you for everything. Help me to remember and to set a new habit that I can be thankful for all of your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bye, friends.
The scripture for today comes from the fourth chapter of Paul's letter to the Philippians, In this lesson, Paul invites the new disciples at Philippi to exult in the Lord who is near at hand.
Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you.
These are the words of the Holy Scripture. Thanks be to God. Miss you, Monty.
Miss you.
Gratitude doesn't just happen. Sometimes it's easy to feel thankful. All is well, going our way. But what about when it isn't? How do we live a thankful life then? You've been there, I bet. Everything's going great. You've got your plans laid out. You know where life is headed. And then, without warning, circumstances change. Plans go by the wayside. Nothing is as you anticipated. Author Diana Butler Bass had that experience. She's a church historian, and she writes about faith and culture. Several years ago, she was doing research for a book on gratitude, looking at the teachings of Scripture and faith across time. It happened to be an election year, and the political rhetoric was becoming more divisive day by day. In addition to that, her husband went through a job upheaval. She became seriously ill, and her family encountered an unexpected crisis. Into that context, she brought her learning about gratitude, about Thanksgiving. Her research and reflections provide resources that we're going to draw from during the next several weeks as we consider what gratitude means for each of us and for all of us. All of us resonate with that unexpected moment of change in our life, and all of us look for the resources that will see us through those difficult times. I found this plaque during a particularly challenging time in my life, and I bought it to put it where I could see it every day. It still hangs in my bedroom as a constant reminder. These kinds of experiences aren't new. I found myself thinking about the prophet Elijah in the Old Testament. Elijah was no shrinking violet, and he took on the 450 prophets of Baal in a contest to see whose God was the strongest. He taunts the other prophets and challenges them to bring down fire, a contest that he ultimately wins. Then he slays these prophets, declaring himself the victor in a mighty triumph. At this point, Queen Jezebel steps in, and she is none too happy that he has taken on her prophets and destroyed them. She vows to get her revenge against Elijah, and he believes her and flees for his life. He journeys through the desert for 40 days and nights, where provisions are made for his food and drink for the journey. Ultimately, he makes it to the mountain, and he ends up in a cave, all alone, fearful, and isolated. It's at that moment that we hear the story that is familiar to many of us. Elijah hears the voice of God ask him what he's doing there. And Elijah responds in a way that's very characteristic of all of us when everything is falling apart. I've been working hard. I've tried to be faithful. Others have deserted me. And now Jezebel has sworn to kill me. I'm the only one left who's being faithful. Elijah then hears a mighty wind, experiences an earthquake, and ultimately, out of the still small voice, he receives the words of assurance that he is not alone. In fact, there are 7,000 others who are faithful, and a successor is being named and prepped to continue his work. Into a moment of fear and despair comes an assurance of God's presence. And in that moment comes a new interpretation of Elijah's past, a new vision for his future, and strength for his present moment. For Elijah to see this, there's need for a pause, a moment to stop, to assess, to look again, to move forward, to pray. These are the steps that our coming journey will offer to us. Time to pause and be aware of all that's going on. Elijah thought he was the only one around, and certainly the only one seeking to be faithful. And yet God reveals to him that there are 7,000 others. Maybe we need to develop a new awareness of those around us, of the gifts being offered to us of kindness and sustenance for the journey of the day. Our first step of gratitude is awareness, developing soft eyes that open us to see new possibilities, blessings taken for granted, gifts offered and received. The second component of our gratitude journey is practice. Even when we don't feel very grateful, even when the only words we have to say are fear and despair, we grow in gratitude by practice. There are techniques that can help us, a gratitude journal, cues that have us pause throughout the day to say thank you for whatever comes to mind at the moment. A cue might be something we see or feel or remember, a bird, a flower, a smile, a kind word, a friend, our next breath. We practice so that we notice when God is speaking through a gentle whisper, when the silence offers to us reassurance. We know that gratitude is a feeling, but it's also a life choice. And the practice of gratitude will open us to new ways of seeing our own life and of connecting with others. And our third component of this gratitude journey is prayer. Ultimately, what we're cultivating is an awareness that life is a gift. In fact, life is the gift. When our gratitude helps open us to that truth, then we will see our own experiences with new insight. We will see our neighbors with new compassion. And we will find a resilience that comes with treasuring each moment. Not necessarily choosing each moment, but trusting that the moments, even the difficult ones, can be used for good. There is always, always, always something to be thankful for. Our scripture that you heard read today comes from the writings of Paul from prison. I hope you will read again Philippians 4, 4 through 9. There is no way to enter into its teachings than to develop our awareness, our practice, our thanksgiving, and to bathe our life with prayer. But there's no more powerful word of joy, no more almost tangible expression of gratitude than this passage, written not from a time of ease, not from a situation of wealth and comfort, but from a grounding of a life of faith that opens us to the gifts around us, that connect us to God and to each other. When Diana Butler Bass entered her time of struggle about how to live with gratitude, when her circumstances were not leading her to feel that way, she began her practice by looking at very small places of thanksgiving. Ultimately, she engaged in journaling. A friend challenged her to write down one blessing each day. That simple challenge began to serve as her cue to notice the good things in life. Sometimes she found it difficult to name even one thing to be grateful for, but sometimes there were two, and sometimes there were three. Some days brought unexpected surprises and joy, simple pleasures, awareness of the kindness of others, of the richness of life. She says she discovered two things. First, when you look for things to be grateful for, you find them. And second, you discover that gratitude grows more gratitude. I want to challenge us to take this opportunity to practice gratitude together. You see, I believe this is critical for us right now. Everywhere we look, there are illustrations of division. There are words of separation. There are weary spirits, and there are opportunities for despair. We can rehearse easily all that we see going wrong. Yet that is not what God has made us for. Gratitude can help us find our way through and can be a blessing that we experience for ourselves and offer to our community and to the world. This is about more than just feeling good feelings. This is about valuing life, our lives, the lives of others, as gifts from God. This is about being aware and receptive so that we look at our past and at our present and anticipate our future in a way that moves us beyond our present circumstances, beyond our fears, beyond our anxieties, and invites us instead into God's life-giving possibilities. So join me, will you, in blessing our world with gratitude. Invite a friend to share in the 7-day guide with you. Post a word of thankfulness on social media each day. Give without expecting in return. pause to wonder. And let's go ahead and practice now. Name one thing you're thankful for today. Jot it down. Start your list. Post it in the comments. Tell a friend or a family member. Let's start the journey that leads us toward a life of gratitude. We begin with awareness. We begin with practice. We begin with prayer.
On May 22nd, I put a small ladder in my bathtub so that I could reach higher to begin painting my bathroom walls. I don't know what happened, but I fell off the ladder onto a tile floor and was knocked out. When I woke up, all I saw was a lot of blood and green paint. I was by myself, but thankfully my phone was near, so I called 911. The EMTs rushed me to the emergency room. I had a 4-inch gash over my eye. My left wrist was broken. I had a fracture in the lumbar region of my spine and a severe concussion. After setting the wrist, I was admitted to the hospital where a huge sign on the wall said, "Fall risk." Did they have to constantly remind me of how foolish I was? I was there for 3 lonely days. No visitors were allowed, not even my pastors. The only people I saw were doctors, nurses, and social workers. I arrived home on Monday afternoon, Memorial Day, and there in my bathroom were 2 ladies. One I knew as the wife of the man who cares for my lawn, and the other I didn't know, but found out she was a good friend of the first lady. To my complete surprise, they were putting the finishing touches on my large bathroom walls. They had come in and painted the entire bathroom and would not even consider taking any payment for their work. I stood there for what seemed like an hour, crying tears of complete gratitude. My family and friends had cleaned the blood and paint off the bathroom floor and taken care of my cat and dog, for which I am most thankful. But the gratitude and love I felt for these 2 ladies, whom I barely knew, was to me God's love through their hands. I still have some residual effects of the fall. My brain is still foggy. My memory is even foggier. My body is still in lots of pain, but these things are insignificant compared to the gratitude that I felt when I walked into the bathroom and saw what had been done out of neighborly love. My thanks to these ladies, to my family and friends throughout this ordeal, but mostly to my God who loves me and takes care of me when I let him, and who sends help when needed most. Thank you.
We have the opportunity each and every week to offer our gifts and our tithes to God as a joyful response to all that we have received. It is possible to give on a regular basis through setting up a regular giving opportunity through your bank or your financial institution. You can also use the QR code that is found on the screen, or go to muncie.org/give, and to give regularly to support the ministries of the church that reach so many people. With hearts filled with gratitude, let us offer our gifts to God this day. Let us pray. God of steadfast love, we thank you for the abundant gifts in our lives, love and grace, clothing and belongings, friends and family. We thank you for the steadfast signs of your loving presence in our world, wondrous works and awesome deeds. We come before you with our offerings, rejoicing in this opportunity to help bring your realm here on earth. Amen.
hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you, and a friend who understands everything you're going through. But you keep standing at a distance in the shadow of your shame. And there's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place and bring it all to the table? There's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your fear, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all table. He can see the weight you carry, the fears that hold your heart. But through the cross you've been forgiven, you're accepted as you are. Trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. Bring it all,
bring it all to the table.
You can nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table.
I hope during this week that you will practice gratitude using the 7-day guide. You can find a copy of it at muncie.org/stewardship if you need to print a copy. And we'd be happy to have you join us and join our congregation as we take this journey of gratitude in these coming weeks. I want to leave you with a quote from poet Maya Angelou, who says this: if you must look back, do so forgivingly. If you must look forward, do so prayerfully. However, the wisest thing you can do is be present in the present, gratefully. Go through this week seeking to be aware, seeking to practice gratitude, seeking to be prayerful, to receive the present as God's gift to you. Amen.